Welcome. I'm Robin Alders, a consulting fellow with the Chatham House Global Health Program, which is a partner organisation with the Poultry Hub. This is the 10th panel in our roadmap series, Discussions for the Future of Poultry, People and Planet. These fortnightly discussions address key issues for sustainable development from the perspective of nutrition security and the global poultry industry. We're aiming to contribute to the UN call that we build back better from the COVID-19 pandemic for the future we want. Just a few housekeeping notes before we get underway. Our discussion today is going to last 1 hour. The event is being recorded and it'll be available on the One Health Poultry Hub website, and a direct link is going to be sent to all of you who have registered. Please put your questions to the panelists through the Zoom Q&A function, which you can access at the bottom of your screens. Feel free to vote for questions that you think are particularly important. And if English is not your first language, please don't let this stop you from posing your questions. I'm Australian, but the British still manage to understand me. The important thing is that we just try to communicate as best we can. I'm going to put as many of your questions as possible to our panelists. And if your question is covered in a previous answer, or if we run out of time, please accept my apologies if we don't get to it. We have an online discussion panel you can access from the website and from your registration link. Please explore this option. We want to hear the questions. We want to listen to your comments, hear your thoughts. Together with today's panel, these online discussions will contribute to briefing notes that we'll be preparing coming from this series. Today's discussion is on antimicrobial resistance governance, behavior and blame, and the associated scientific and ethical challenges. As we get underway, we'd welcome your thoughts on this first topic via the first poll, which should be coming onto your screen now. The poll will disappear from your screen once you vote. So please take your time, read through these the question, and select your option. And now I'm delighted to welcome our expert panelists for today. Dr. Vikas Agarwal is the Fleming Fund Regional Lead for South Asia, and Professor Anita Kotwani is the Head of Pharmacology at the VP Chest Institute within the University of Delhi. Welcome. Each of you has 10 minutes to present your thoughts, and we'll give you a signal at 9 minutes, and then you'll have 1 minute to wrap up. So with no further ado, over to you, Dr. Agarwal. Thank you.
Thank you, Robin. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon the location from where you have tuned into. I will be spending next 10 minutes to talk about AMR and its governance and implementation related issues, mainly from South Asia perspective. Next slide, please. AMR, or antimicrobial resistance, arises when bugs survive the medicine that would normally kill or stop them. It means that we may lose our fight to diseases causing death or economic loss. The question here is, how serious is AMR problem? Well, as you can see through these two graphs, first one on the left-hand side, based on the review led by economist Jim O'Neill, which estimated unless action is taken, the death from AMR by 2050 could be as high as 10 million lives each year. And to put things in comparison to COVID-19, the graph on the right-hand side estimates that AMR could overshadow effects of COVID-19 in next 30 years by 5 times. So yes, AMR is a serious political, social, and economic problem. And the impact could be significantly much higher in regions like South Asia that comprises of low and middle income countries and have huge population that lives in poverty. Next slide, please. Recognizing AMR as a dominant global health concern, 68th World Health Assembly in 2015 endorsed a global action plan on AMR that has 5 strategic objectives, which are listed here in the slide. I will not go in detail, but these are the 5 objectives. And Assembly also urged all its member states to develop AMR National Action Plan that are aligned to these five objectives of the Global Action Plan. And the member states have responded to this call. For example, as you can see from this graph, based on the situational analysis undertaken for the countries in the WHO Sierra region, revealed significant progress in the implementation of National Action Plan across various focus areas from the year 2016 to 2018. Next slide, please. Although countries have made a good progress, as we have seen in the earlier slide, they have the National Action Plan governance mechanism in place, and at least this is true for the countries in the Southeast Asia. But the question here is, like, is this truly reflective of the country's ownership of AMR? Well, on in-depth analysis, we will notice that some countries lack AMR policies, standards, and guidelines related to AMR response. Most countries lack effective operational plans and regulatory frameworks. And furthermore, some countries, the National Action Plan is not yet endorsed. That means it's still in the draft stage. The National Action Plan are not yet costed, and there is no financial commitment made to support the action plan. In some countries where there is a budget allocation for AMR, it is mainly restricted for human health sector, and thus animal health sector has made very less progress on AMR. This is due to the limited resources and limited systemic capacity. Furthermore, environment sector in particular is even far more left out and very less integrated. Next slide, please. So we can definitely see that AMR response is more tilted towards human health sector. In countries, the coordination committees on AMR are led by the human health sector and are inadequately represented by other sector, non-health sector. This is impacting One Health engagement and effective multi-sectoral coordination in true sense. With regard to AMR surveillance, which is one of the core objectives under the National Action Plan, and also being supported by Fleming Fund, the surveillance system is still in very early stages of implementation and even more lagging in animal and environment sector. In human health, it's emerging, but animal health and environment sector, they are far more lagging. A point to be noted here, unlike human health sector, where we have global antimicrobial surveillance, resistance surveillance system, or CLASS, it's known as CLASS, which is an internationally standardized mechanism to collect, analyze, and share AMR data at the global level. There is no such mechanism for AMR data from the animal health sector. Next slide, please. So what is needed? The ownership, political commitment for AMR response by the country is critical for tackling AMR. Countries should ensure that action plans have accountability matrices such as budget and resource commitment. Countries should also find ways to mainstream AMR into their existing program to accommodate stressed budget. For example, routine training program for clinicians could include messaging on antibiotic stewardship, etc. In some countries in South Asia, majority of AMR data is held in private sector laboratories, so it's very important to also include them in AMR surveillance. In addition, there should be a mechanism to include experts from the civil society, from universities, from think tank. In the technical group discussions, which there's a technical working groups which has been established at the country level. But as of now, these technical working groups are largely restricted to government staff or the technical experts which are associated with government hospitals. So there should be a mechanism to include non-governmental experts. And these non-governmental experts or civil society could play an important role. They can share evidences and policy idea to foster evidence-based decision-making. But it's also very important for a meaningful engagement that civil society should also contribute constructive feedback and actionable solutions rather than only showing the shortcomings in the system. Next slide, please. So finally, the countries, like countries in the region like South Asia, could be disproportionately affected by AMR, which means government in these countries must be fully equipped to own and respond to AMR. We can't blame any single entity. All sectors and stakeholders have a role to play and should collaborate and coordinate for an effective AMR response. It should be everyone's concern. That's all from my side. Thank you very much. Next slide. That's the thank you slide. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Dr. Agarwal. That was really motivating, but also a little scary. Your presentation, I'm sure, is going to generate many questions. While we wait for questions to come in, I wanted to ask you what you think can be done to ensure that all sectors are equitably represented in the response to antimicrobial resistance.
Thank you very much, first of all, and that's a very nice question, very good question. And as I said in my presentation, and as it is recommended, that for containing and controlling AMR, a coordinated action across all sectors is must. For these countries have established multi-sectoral coordination committees, but as I said, these committees are chaired by health sector. The representation and involvement from other sectors is limited. For example, in meetings, participation is usually inadequate, especially from the non-health sector. I think to overcome this challenge and to answer your question, there could be multiple solutions. First one would be to have sharp terms of reference for the participants, for the members of the coordination committee, so that they have defined rules and responsibilities so that they set responsibility across sector and also accountability. Secondly, I think for equitable representation, government could consider AMR coordination committee to sit at supra-ministerial level, such as maybe within Prime Minister office or at the cabinet level, so that not single sector dominates the narrative or available funding on AMR. Or AMR committee could also introduce rotating heads or rotating chair, so that each sector can get a chance to lead national AMR discussions. Another point to ensure participation, which is very important, I think, is to ensure that each sector has got sufficient budgetary allocation. And budgetary allocation is not only needed to support AMR response, but in absence of resources, in absence of budget, we can't ensure involvement. You know, for sectors to get involved, they need resources. And that's a critical point. Although there is some external funding which is available in some countries, like external funding, which are providing some resources to non-health sector for AMR response, but for long-term sustainability and true involvement of the sectors in AMR response, the country must allocate resources. And this is very much true for animal health sector, for environmental health sector. And they can begin the priority activity, to begin with. But I think these are the solutions which I can think of, which could kind of lead to multi-sectoral involvement in true sense. Thank you very much. I hope that answers your question.
That's a fabulous response. Thank you. And we certainly look forward to solving this need to have intersectoral coordination and active co-implementation. Before we have our second presentation, if we could just see the results of that first poll. And what we can see is that people are really firmly saying that we need to look at both increased government regulation and enforcement, but also education and how important that is. So that's a fabulous result. And it really sets up the discussion to hand over to Professor Kotwani. Thanks very much.
Hello, everyone. Greetings of the day. And first and foremost, let me first thank Professor Robin, Chatham House, and One Health Poultry Hub for giving me this opportunity to interact with such a big audience across the globe to discuss with them or interact with this audience about this important aspect of antimicrobial resistance. Next slide, please. As we have known from our previous presentation that antimicrobial resistance is a silent pandemic, but it goes unnoticed by majority of the population. Here I would like to again stress, though everybody is aware, that one of the very important drivers of antimicrobial resistance is overuse or inappropriate use of antibiotics. And it is the total volume of antibiotics which put pressure on the selection pressure on microbes. If we are exposing microbes to again and again to this antibiotics or antimicrobial agents, the susceptible microbes, they get killed, and the resistant microbes, they grow and multiply. And that is the reason how this AMR is increasing so rapidly, because we are using huge amount of antibiotics. And these antibiotics are not only used in human sector, as it is shown in this simplified figures, but also in animal sector. And we all are aware where all it can be used in animal sector and also in the environment. Directly or indirectly, antibiotic and antibiotic resistant genes are present in the environment. And another important factor which leads to a huge amount of antibiotics in water bodies and in environment is the pharma effluent, because intentionally or unintentionally, antibiotics are released from pharma effluent to the environment. So there is a very intricate mesh of connectivity between human, animal, and the environmental sector. Now, finding out that which particular sector is more important and how much contribution each sector is playing is very, very difficult, because it is not easy. And it will depend upon the various regions where these things are. But we definitely know that this is all these three sectors act as reservoir for antibiotics and antibiotic resistant gene and are very, very important. We cannot tackle AMR just by addressing human side or animal side or environmental side. So what we call these days, or the buzzword these days, is one health approach. This is a term which is very frequently used these days, but unfortunately, not very clearly defined, or the One Health committees, they're not clearly represented, as was discussed in the last presentation also. And even if all the actors or stakeholders are there, their activities are not like equally representative. So we really need a One Health approach to tackle AMR. Here, I would like to say that AMR is also driven by human behavior. So it has a great social component. We need to have social science research, which will tell us what are the main problems, how this human behavior can be tackled, and solution can also be found from social science research. Next slide, please. So now we know that countries have recognized the extent and burden of AMR, and they have developed their national action plan, aligning it very well with the global action plan developed by WHO. Now, for all these countries, WHO technical support was given. There is a template, and that's how it was. The document was prepared by most of the countries, because all these member states, they signed in World Health Assembly that by 2017, they will have this document of National Action Plan. Now, if we look at any National Action Plan, this is just for an example, I have pasted a National Action Plan of AMR, but all these National Action Plan, they have many objectives under each specific objective of National Action Plan. And under each objective, there are activities and intervention. And they are not only activities and interventions mentioned, they have also mentioned the time frame, whether this activity be of short term, medium term, or long term. Now, these activities are mentioned, even the stakeholders are mentioned in most of the activities in most of the national action plans. Then there is a section of governance system. And a very nice depiction of multi-stakeholder committees are there, and in many of the national action plan of Southeast Asian countries, for each objective also they have mentioned their multi-sectorial committee, including their chairman, etc. And after that is there is a monitoring and evaluation section in this national action plan. Again, it is a very detailed one that what methodology they will use to monitor and evaluate the particular activity. So in this national action plan or the activities, the one of the important links is that how we can contain AMR by appropriate use of antibiotics or to reduce selection pressure on microbes. And second is to reduce infection rates. So if we reduce selection pressure on microbes and if we reduce infection rate, the net result would be there would be decrease in AMR or there would be reversal of AMR. But now let's see into 2021, where are we? Have countries done some monitoring and evaluation? After say 17, they have prepared their document. So where are we? Have we monitored something? Is there some report available? Next slide, please. So it has been observed that for in many countries, the policies have mentioned that MND section is there. So is true, as I said, for NAP AMR. And it is mentioned that at regular interval or yearly, the MND will be done. But is that done? No. We are really not aware what where exactly each country is, whether the short-term goals have been achieved or not. So what could be the reason why MNDE is not there when we have a very good document prepared there? Why these activities are either not happening and there is no evaluation? First of all, it is the lack of infrastructure. This is one of the biggest challenge, that there is no infrastructure available to do monitoring and evaluation. And second, most challenging, especially for AMR, is there are various units of government units which are responsible for this activity, but there is no accountability. So if there is no accountability, there is no infrastructure, so generally this MNE is not happening. Now, other thing is, even if auditing is done, even if some monitoring and evaluation is being done, but the reports are not, or the we don't see the reports, why that is so? Because there is a fear of getting blamed for any negative findings. Because, and they are rightly so, there is this scapegoat mechanism that nobody wants to own this negative findings and they want to blame it to somebody else. So this is something very, very important people should realize, that there is a fear of getting blamed. So what is the behavior of all this? That either they don't want to do auditing or they want to delay it. Even if auditing is done, then the reports are not out. So this behavior of just closing your eyes from the real ground situation is one must has to tackle. So what could be the solutions? The solutions could be that we should have a monitoring unit in the nodal agencies with clear TORs that at 6 monthly interval, this would be done. And this TOR should mention that they have to report weakness in the system and suggest. So if we have clear cut TORs with regular intervals, then only something can be done for MNE and evaluation of activity. Next slide, please. Now that was a little bit about governance. Now coming to other part of our discussion today, and I will take one case study. And very briefly, I'll show you that as we, the poll question is that it is over-the-counter antibiotics are available. So we have done few studies in India, as well as I have data and done some in other Southeast Asian countries, that it has been found that yes, there is a huge amount of antibiotic use and inappropriate uses there. Qualitative studies conducted with various stakeholders clearly show that there is a blame game. Doctors want to blame pharmacists that they give on their own without prescription. They are blaming informal providers. Even they blame government also that why regulations are not implemented. And they also blame customers for overuse, misuse of antibiotics. Pharmacists blame on private doctors having a high fee. So they think they are doing a social just cause or noble cause for poor patient that they give them antibiotics and they say that it is not we who are deciding, they copy the prescription of doctors. So whatever doctors are prescribing to poor patient who cannot go to private doctors, we give them this antibiotics. And if we talk to consumers, consumers say it is fault of government that there is poor access of public facility and we cannot afford at private sector. So we have no choice but to take, I self-medicate ourselves or to take advice of pharmacists. Next slide. And about awareness, when we have done all these studies, it was found that even high school students and teachers, they have poor awareness of antibiotics and AMR. Informal dispensers, which are commonly there at the licensed retail pharmacies in India and other Southeast Asian countries, that they are not aware of AMR, and pharmacists also have poor knowledge. Doctors perceive demand for antibiotics from patients, and they also want to play safe. There is no prescription auditing or antimicrobial consumption at facility level or at any levels. And regulators, if we talk, they say we are short of staff. We cannot do inspection of so many retail pharmacies. And even if we go for inspection, we are more bothered about psychotropic medicine rather than antibiotics. Not much awareness and regulation is there for environmental sector. Lastly, I would like to say, next slide, that yes, we need to do awareness programs, and all of these are mentioned in the NAP AMR. The first objective is about awareness and inclusion of AMR in curriculum. We need to do some qualitative research to find out the behavior and to find out the intervention. I would like to stress here that we need to measure antibiotic consumption. When we say surveillance, surveillance doesn't mean only antibiotic resistance. Surveillance means measuring antibiotic consumption in human animal sector and also levels of antibiotics in the environment like hospital waste, pharma effluent, soil and water bodies, et cetera, with a good M&E system. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Professor Kotwani. That was a wonderful overview of the complexity of this governance issue. We've got some wonderful questions coming in. Nurun Naha from Bangladesh is asking, can the momentum of the awareness campaign for COVID-19 be picked up for AMR? What do you think, Anita?
Yeah, that's a very good question. That usually we are blaming COVID-19 for everything, that this activity was not done because of COVID, we couldn't do this. But I think as far as AMR awareness is concerned, we can really pick up the momentum which COVID-19 has started. Why? Because COVID-19 has given us a very good experience that how a good communication and awareness program can be done and can reach out to larger population. So we can learn from their experience. And COVID-19 has brought multidisciplinary people together, very good communication teams together. They have got celebrities roped in. And in India, I'll give you one example that if you call somebody on mobile, so before the bell rings, you listen to a message about COVID-19 for a few seconds. So similarly, we can do it for AMR. And one very important point, how these policymakers and regulators can really take up this for AMR also, because the teams are almost the same. The higher officials in Ministry of Health are almost the same, which are on task force of COVID-19. So they are well aware of that they can use this communication and skill and awareness. So this is something important. And another thing I would like to say, yes, COVID-19 has taught general public that there is something called viral infections and where antibiotics are not effective. So if we can take that yes, this viral flu, viral fever, cough and cold, they are all viral and antibiotics are not effective. So please do not take antibiotics for them. So I think this is the right moment where we can really reach out to large population and can tell them that how we can really use antibiotics appropriately. And lastly, one more thing I would like to say, because I've done a lot of focus group discussion in other Southeast Asian countries also, where I have done with the consumers and focus group discussion about what is AMR. Nobody understands AMR. For them, this term is big term. They can't understand. So when we are doing our general public awareness, it should be called antibiotic resistance, or we should call it reversal of antibiotic resistance or appropriate use of antibiotics, so that they don't listen to some big term and they don't read it. So I think we are in a very good position at this moment with the same officials on board for AMR and COVID-19 from Ministry of Health. They should take up this momentum and use it for AMR awareness. I hope I have been able to answer your query.
Yes, that's great. And I really thank you for mentioning the importance of effective risk communication and using terms that people understand, not terms that make us technical people feel comfortable. So that you've raised a really important point. We have a lot of questions coming in. We're going to do our best to get through them. And I absolutely have to ask this question from Rashid Mahmood in Bangladesh. I'm not sure whether it's going to be Vikas or you, Anita, who's going to, you might both like to have a chance to respond to this. Rashid is asking, in Bangladesh, small poultry farmers rely heavily on feed medicine dealers and the decisions and the recommendations they made, because they buy everything related to poultry farming on credit, and they use unnecessary antibiotics without getting advice from registered veterinarians. In this case, how can we encourage farmers to practice rational use of antibiotics?
This question, sorry. No, Vikas, you go ahead.
No, thank you very much. No, I think it's kind of, reality there on the ground. And when we are talking about the small farmers, they rely very much, for these kind of things on the production and decision is kind of, so the real challenge is how to balance out between the profits and more because of the fact that with diseases like bird flu and other things, the profit margin also get reduced, and that may lead to some kind of, practices as raised by Rashid here. I think the sound regulatory practices and sound kind of, support from the government side, it should be very kind of welcome step in that regard, because there need to be some kind of policy on how to make farmers accessible to kind of, medicines and credit line through institutions, not relying on the medicine dealers. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Vikas. Anita, did you want to add to that?
No, let's have another question. If there are many questions, that would be good.
Vikas, there are many questions, and I just love this one from Hung Tran, who's asking, is there any developing country which has success in allocating budget for antimicrobial resistance? And if there are, could you please share the experience of that country? I might say any country in the world. I don't know that it's just developing countries. Any country in the world that's doing this well.
There are countries, I will, and that too in South Asia country, which has got budget for AMR, which I said that it's not that none of the country has allocated, but the challenge is that the budget is mainly for operational activities. The allocation is ad hoc. The allocation is not yet to the national action plan, and because the action plans are not yet costed. So it's kind of, so when we say that there is no allocation, so I meant to say that there is no allocation as per the AMR national action plan. But there is some kind of budget. There is budget, for example, in Bangladesh, there is budget for AMR, right? But again, that too in human health sector and in some other countries like Bhutan, in India, there is budget allocation for there, but not for the national action plan because it's yet to be costed. But there are certain activities which are there, which are being undertaken, but not in the 100% on NAP. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
I would also like to add,
Anita, do you have some good news for us?
Good news is, yes, what Vikas said, yes, India also has. Thailand is doing good work on AMR. They have budget and they have good manpower of pharmacists in their FDA, which are doing good work. But the NAP AMR, it is not budgeted, or for each activity, the amount of funds is not put. In India, I know that they have huge amount of funds for AMR, but allocation to different animal sector, environment sector, that is a big challenge because it is not actually done in NAP AMR for each activity. So that is the challenge. That's why I said when they are making NAP AMR, they should put funds for M&E, they should put funds for each activity so that it is easy for government to then give them that much fund. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks very much. We'll keep going with this growing list of questions. Nigel Gibbons has a question, and I'll ask maybe one of you to answer. You can decide. Livestock production will increase to meet the needs of a growing global population. Antimicrobial risks may increase with certain production systems, especially if management systems are inadequate. How can this be mitigated whilst enabling the livestock sectors to flourish?
Again, I would say that, you know, that's what the national action plans and frameworks and the policies need to address at the country level. There need to be kind of involvement of industrial associations, the farmer association, the private sector into the think tank, so that the policies and the frameworks do address these kind of things. And that's need to be done at the country level. And in countries where kind of, you know, which are in federal structure, that maybe they may need to have those kind of similar plans for the state level kind of, you know, frameworks. So I think that's what each country needs to do. And it would be difficult to have a kind of, you know, single cut at the global level for every country to follow. But that's where every country is trying to do. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks very much for that. Now, the next most popular question is for you, Vikas, but I'm going to skip and I'm going to go to one that seems very suited for Anita. It's coming from Matt Hennessy. Anita, how can the action plans go beyond trying to change people's behavior and the level of government enforcement to try to address some of the structural problems which drive antibiotic use, such as fragile healthcare systems and the reliance on intensive livestock production systems?
Yeah, so means how social science can help in all these? That is the question, if I've understood.
Yes, social science certainly sounds like a social science question.
Yeah, it sounds like that, how qualitative or social science research or behavior thing can affect. See, one is our behavior, like in poultry or whatever we were talking about, livestock or human, that we have a behavior to use it without thinking. Like for all cough and cold, we are using antibiotics. There are plenty of reports. I have done many studies that even doctors are using. And if you ask doctor, they'll say, oh, they have already taken first generation, second generation antibiotic, we have to give something more. And why you are giving? Because it's a viral thing. They said, yeah, it is viral, but just to protect, just to be safe, so there is no secondary infection. Similarly for other sectors also, like in animal sectors, that many a times antibiotics are used just to be that they will protect the entire flock or they'll increase the meat production. But now there are reports that it is not true, but rather it is producing AMR, which is really affecting our economy also. There could be many other probiotics or other agents which can be given instead of antibiotics. So we need to do these experiments also. We need to have focus group discussions with them, telling them that if you don't use this antibiotics, and these are the reports when we have not used this antibiotic, but you use probiotic, And there are reports now which clearly indicate that there is no use of antibiotic, but it is our fear that there would be less meat production or there would be disease in the poultry or for human being, that there would be secondary infection, that we are using it. So we really need to discuss with them. We need to involve community with us. It has to be both top-down and bottom-up approach where governments are also involved. At the moment, our livestock departments and all, they are not involved to that level so that they can tackle the questions of farmers. So it is mainly in the hands of private sector. So it really requires a thorough investigation, and all the stakeholders need to come together and discuss with them, take community and farmers along with them. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Inclusive policy making sounds very good to me. Vikas, we have a question for you here from Zabaid Khan. And if I pronounce people's names incorrectly, please forgive me. This is a great question. How do you think we may convince the Ministry of Planning and or Ministry of Finance to allocate resources, especially into non-health ministries and departments?
Very good question, Zubaid. And, you know, that's the challenge that's being faced by almost every developing countries. And as I said, that it's not kind of, you know, like governments are not convinced to invest in AMR. AMR is a recognized health issue. But the challenge is that AMR need to compete with other challenges, other diseases. For example, like in COVID, though there is much more resource allocation, but resource allocation is mainly for virology lab. And, you know, likewise, AMR need to compete and will be competing with other health priorities. So it's very important, you know, for planners, for finance ministry, when they have to have decision and in already kind of, you know, stressed environment where every single penny is premium, and how to make allocations to AMR and how to convince. I think first and foremost, based on analysis of the situation on the ground, we need to pick up, the countries need to pick up the priority issue. What is, you know, like rather than getting the budget for entire action plan, they should prioritize, okay, which are the critical activity which can be budgeted at the first instance, which are critical activities, which are vital activities, and which are desirable, some kind of, you know, like prioritization as per that. And also, you know, like the planning could be on the incremental basis so that a budget requirement is not huge from the day one. But and as I said, the mainstreaming, you know, we should find out avenues where AMR related activities could be piggybacked on other activities so that there is, rationalized budget requirement. And lastly, which is most important, is to have evidence and is to have, you know, like strong scientific papers coming out of the country. And that's what scientific community and non-health sectors need to invest into, have a kind of advocacy and to have these kind of things to be heard in the policy corridors, because usually, you know, as I have seen in the countries, the technical people like the ministries, the director generals, everyone is highly convinced. But for them to convince the policymaker, the finance and the planners, they need some strong evidence. They really need to make a case. They really need to make an economic case for AMR. And for that, they need to sit along with civil society. They need to sit with expert academia. They need to have the data analysis, and they need to have capacity to analyze the data and to present. So, you know, like, and that's where we feel that even kind of, you know, senior officials, they need policy advocacy training on how to advocate for causes like AMR. And also they need to kind of, you know, get some orientation on how to identify, how to have sharp documents and what to present and how to fight for the budget. The fight would always be there. But again, so just to summarize first, there would be a fight for budget allocation, but some of the priority activity could be picked. And thirdly, the advocacy is needed, and that require evidences, evidence-based advocacy. So I would stop there. I don't want to take too much of time. Thank you.
Thank you. It is a really important question, and that need for data is linked into this next question, which I might put to you, Anita. This is coming from Jim McGrain, probably sitting in Spain right now, but he's worked in many different countries. He's saying that there is that VCAS raised the issue that there's no internationally recognized AMR or AMU surveillance system for the animal health sector. Should it not be a function and responsibility of the tripartite, that's FAO, OIE, and WHO, to fill this gap due to the required One Health approach, which is essential to reduce the health threat presented by antimicrobial resistance? What do you think, Anita?
No, this is their responsibility and they are working on it, but it is not that simple for animal sector to quantify the use, because for human being, a human being is one species only, that it is, DDDs are very clearly defined. So when we do antimicrobial consumption for human being, it's very clear we have DDDs for that, that is defined daily doses, like for amoxicillin or for any antibiotic, these DDDs are there. So you have the total number of grams used for one particular antibiotic, you fill in, you have DDDs for it, and it's calculate your consumption. So for human, it is simpler, but for animals, it is a bit difficult. It is challenging, but they are working on it. And there are reports in which they have tried for big animals to find out that how we can measure antibiotic consumption and can put into it. So the process is on, and I'm sure in very near future, we will have a methodology for antimicrobial consumption for animal sector also. But even if we don't have that, government should try to find out that what are the animal sector using, because their preparations are different. So from manufacturer side, we can collect data that these are the animal preparation and yearly how much, which antibiotics are being used. So we can have a surrogate indicators, which can tell us if not correctly as for human, but for animals, that how much antibiotics are being used. It's a big challenge, but they are working on it and soon it will be done. But to tell you about human being antimicrobial consumption, there is not much data from developing countries. Whatever antimicrobial consumption pattern we have is mainly from European countries. They have a good network system of ISAC, European system, where they are doing for many years. And they can clearly indicate that among the all EU countries, like France at one time was the highest consumer of antimicrobial consumption. And when they put the data, and they changed the habit. There was this huge awareness campaign and education. Everything was done, and France can reduce their antimicrobial consumption. But in developing countries, as of now, very, very few countries have started. Like very recently, Maldives has done some antimicrobial consumption data collection and as per WHO tool, because very recently WHO has finalized their tool and some developing countries have started using this tool. But soon there would be a tool for health sector as well. Thank you.
I would like to add a point here, if I can. Yes. Sorry. So AMU is now being covered by OIE and they are working on database. FAO is working on a database on animal health, on AMR. And there's another challenge, the sites like the laboratories in the animal health sectors are also very limited from where data is generated. So there is much more lab network, which has been established at the country level. So, that's another challenge to get that data on AMR surveillance from the animal health sector. But AMU is definitely being covered by OIE currently. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Vikas. And I think we have time for one more question at least. And Claire Chandler is following up on the question put by Matt Hennessy. And I think it's going to be more of an issue of equity. And looking, the question that Claire says, to follow up on Matt Hennessy's question, this was not just about behavior of end users or prescribers. The question, which may emerge from social science observations, is about what we can do to address structural issues that drive a need for antibiotic use by end users. Beyond focus group discussions to tell people what to do, how can national action plans help countries address structural issues that drive antimicrobial use? So things like poor healthcare systems. Right. I think this is a question, if both of you have a minute or so to answer this one, it is quite important.
It is quite important. And as you said, that primary healthcare system is the kind of, you know, skeleton and should be strengthened to avoid, this kind of, you know, overprescription. If the patients are treated through a good gatekeeping kind of process, then definitely, you know, unnecessary prescription of antibiotic use, antibiotics can be restricted. And then secondly, the quality of the drugs is also an important factor, and regulatory mechanisms for the good quality antibiotics so that the unnecessary overprescription and other things are not in place. Thirdly, I would say that, international regulation in some countries, especially in South Asia context, even though country government has got good framework, but because of free international borders, the antibiotics use and these things cannot be controlled. And that's another challenge which countries across in the region, they need to sit and they need to have some kind of international mechanism also to control that. I would stop there and I will give a chance to Dr. Anita to say in case. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, there are plenty of things which can be done. A simple things which can improve antibiotic use or optimize antibiotic use, to have a central medicine list and do it as per access, watch, and reserve, which WHO has recently categorized. None of these developing countries have categorized their EML as per access, watch, and reserve. If we have our EML in place, we revise them, and we have standard treatment guidelines, which are to be followed by both public and private sector, then we are definitely going to change the behavior of using higher-end antibiotics. So we need to have EML in place. We need to have a good supply chain system. Our primary care should get excess antibiotics or whatever the essential medicine list is there. There are reports from India. I have done studies that whatever government is procuring is also being given to primary care. So, and in primary care, there are stockouts. So whatever antibiotic is available, even if it is a broad spectrum is available, everybody is getting that broad spectrum. So if we take these small steps of EML, supply chain system, good standard treatment guidelines provided to them with backup with education, definitely improvement would be there. So education, awareness, EML, standard treatment guideline, and lastly, prescription audit at each and every primary healthcare in government, unless we measure them, because if you talk to doctors, they say that we use it judiciously. We don't give it for viral fevers. We don't give it for diarrhea. But the moment you see their prescription, all acute diarrhea patient, adult patient, they are getting antibiotics, or cough and cold are getting. So we need to do prescription audit. We need to have our EML in place. So few things, if we take into consideration, definitely our system would improve and there would be appropriate use of antibiotics. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. And really, that we have so many unanswered questions. I do hope you'll carry over onto the Slack discussion channel. They're very important ones. I'm going to simply rephrase a question from Delislava Velcheva. It's a great question. We don't have time to answer it, so I'm just going to paraphrase and say, how can we implement and create regulations that work for both low and middle income countries and high income countries? And how do we ensure that we have regulations that are appropriate where there's a lack of infrastructure and a lack of funding? So I think that's a really important point and something that we do need to keep working on. But as I say, we're out of time. So sorry, such a great discussion, but we can continue online. I'd like you to join with me in thanking our two expert panelists. They've highlighted several important points for us to consider. And if we can just have a look at their key messages, our takeaway message. So the first one is that having a national action plan is not enough. Multi-sectoral collaboration is crucial from day one. The antimicrobial resistance response must be mainstreamed, and there needs to be a government monitoring unit established. Investing in public education and awareness is vital to change behavior in a way that's feasible for them. And it's really important to introduce the One Health concept and appropriate use of antibiotics in high school curricula. And I think that's a fabulous recommendation. For those of you in our audience, we really want to have your perspective on today's discussion. So do please, this is your chance via our second poll. Let us know what you think of today's discussion, and we'll present those your results just as we go to the end. Thanks again to our wonderful panelists, Dr. Vikas Agarwal and Professor Anita Kotwani, to our tech team working in the background to make everything run as well as it does, and to you, our audience, for your interest and your questions. As I mentioned, do please keep going on our Slack channel. This is a really important discussion. Do it today, do it tomorrow, do it next week, but do contribute to this discussion so it can feed into our briefing document. The next event in this series is going to be on the 28th of April. There's a spring break coming up in the UK, so you've got a couple of weeks breather. So on the 28th of April at the same time, please join me for a discussion with Professor Mark Howden of the Australian National University and Dr. Sylvia Karpagan from the Indian chapter of Equal Health. They'll be looking at food systems, climate change, and animal source food. Can we nourish humanity, our domestic animals, and save the planet as well? So let's have a look at those results of the second poll. So there's a little bit of a split this time, the most popular answer being that there are effective approaches that could be adopted. And so that's encouraging, but importantly, the next one, more medical, veterinary, and social science research is required to develop effective ways to reduce antimicrobial resistance. So thanks so much for those answers. We look forward to you joining us again on the 28th of April. Thanks so much and stay safe, everyone.
Thank you.